Good morning, Church. I give glory and honor to our living God for guiding us and bringing us together to have fellowship through via Zoom Sunday service. I also welcome each one of you to this 23rd Jan 2022 Naga Christian Fellowship Pune Sunday service. If anyone out here is joining us for the first time, I, on behalf of the church, warmly welcome you. And every Sunday at 11 a.m., we have NCF service through via Zoom, so you are welcome to be a part of this fellowship. And also every Sunday at 12 p.m., we have Sunday school through via Zoom. In Colossians chapter 1, the word of God says, "Rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness." Let us all unite our heart and let me pray. Our Father who are in heaven, Lord, want to thank you and praise you, Lord. Thank you so much for your love. Thank you so much for your blessings. And also thank you so much for this beautiful day that you have given to us. Lord, we want to thank you and praise you for bringing us here together before your presence to have fellowship with you, Lord. We commit all of our life and our fellowship into your hand. We submit all the participants' life into your hand, Lord. Guide us and lead us according to your will, Lord. And Lord, as we continue to worship you, bless us and lead us, Lord. For we commit all our life, our time, and our fellowship, everything into mighty care. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I welcome the worship team to lead us into worship. Kindly take your time.
Good morning, church. Today, it's a new day. We gather to worship God's name. And before we start with all our program, I'd like to read a piece of the scriptures that is in Psalms 24. Verse 1 says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false. He will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Savior. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, O God of Jacob." So this morning we're seeking the Lord, and let's pray that our heart can be pure, that we can face the Lord with a clean heart. He's the only one who can clean our hearts completely. And through Jesus, we can have a good and the best relationship we can have with God. So let's pray and start worshiping God. Lord, we thank you so much for this morning. Thank you because we can gather here online, but still you are amongst us, and we want to say that you are our God, that there's no other like you, that we submit to you, Lord, but also that we surrender and that we just declare that without you we cannot do anything. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you because you're the King of Kings. Thank you because you're our Savior. And thank you because our hearts can rest in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's start.
Thank you. Steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. For my life is wholly bound to Him. Oh, how strange and divine I can see. All is mine, yet not I, but true Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but true Christ in me. No fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future's sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but true Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me. until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, not I, but true Christ in me. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus. All the glory evermore to Him. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, not I, but true Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but true Christ in me. Yet not I, but true Christ in me. Yet not I, but true Christ in me.
Join me as I intercede on all behalf of us. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful grace which you have given to us. Thank you, Lord, for this service which we are having today, and also for this day where it was set apart so that we all, as church, as community members, can come together and praise you, Lord. As a song says, Lord Father, forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Yes, Lord, you are great and you are powerful and you are loving. And through that nature itself, we live and with the expectation that we will see something new each day. Thank you, Lord, for being with us all this long. And thank you for showing us how kind you are and how merciful you are towards our life. Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for what you have done on the cross for us. Father, we always, whenever we remember our day, when we are in trouble, when we are in pain, Father, you bore it all for us. And we, through that cross, Lord, we are still alive and able to worship you in this manner. Father, especially we are thankful to you for the life of the community members and for this church that you have given us, Lord, that through this medium also we are able to worship you. And through your grace, Lord, we are always be able to do it. Father, especially I want to bring some of the concerns of the church into your mighty care with the expectation that, Lord, you will answer our prayers soon. Father, I want to bring the need, very need of the church, Lord, that need of a new pastor, a pastor who is the leader of the church. Father, we pray that, Lord, this very important need of this church will be fulfilled in your name, Lord, Father. Everything what they are looking for and all the search and everything, all the decisions which are pending and all the matters they have to discuss on, Lord, Father, we submit it in your hands because we know, Lord, you know the better for us. You know what is best for us. And especially for this church, which is based on your grace and the diversity, and the diversity which is based on love and unity, Lord. We pray that this will never be able to shaken because, Lord, what you are going to provide for us. Father, we pray that as the search and also for the expectation of the new pastor has been risen, Lord, we pray that you will provide this very need of this church, Lord. We also pray for the expectations of the church as in for the driver, Lord. Father, we pray that there's a need of connecting people through the service and through the providence of whatever that person will be or that may he or she be able to do the service in a better way, Lord, Father. These things seem to be small, but these are very important aspects of the church, Lord. So that is why we want to submit it in your hands, Lord, because, Lord, we have faith in you and we rely on you at most. Father, we also pray for, especially for the people who are sick, who are affected with the common flu and the cold and cough of this weather, not only in this place, even though they are members of this church and they are at home, Lord, we want to submit them and we want to take them and bring them into your throne of grace. Because, Father, you are our healer, you are our provider, and you are our caretaker. And we want to rely on you in this manner so that our faith will be stronger in you always, Lord. That we want to bring them in next with the hope that, Lord, you will heal them. Also, you will recover them as fast as possible. Father, Lord, help them to recover their sickness. Also, all the members who are not even sick and still living in this time of trouble, we pray that, Lord, you will protect them with your angels and guard their sickness, guard their health with all the means which is troublesome to them, Lord, Father. We also pray especially for these times, which is all bad for us, which is this time, which is very hard for us, that we are able to, we have to connect in this way. But Lord, thank you for this goodness you have shown in these troubled times as well. Father, with this, we want us, all the members and all the community members, to have a heart so to be thankful towards these things. Father, give us a heart of concern, even though I'm praying this right now, but let us all have that heart so that we can pray for the needy. We can pray for the work and the mission which we have elected us for, Lord Father. We pray that this church be a beacon in your name so that people can come and see what our God is through this church, Lord. Help us to stand more firm in your grace and also in your word so that our pillars of your faith be strong each and every day, Lord Father. We pray that all these things, what we ask for, and all these things, what we look for, Father, be done in your name because we believe in you. With these expectations and with this request, Lord, we want to submit everything in your hands. In Jesus' name, I ask this prayer. Amen. Now I welcome Mrs. Bhavna Barosa for the offering prayer.
In Romans 12, verse 1, Paul encourages our church, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Lord, we come to you as church, as your people, Lord, and we worship you, Lord, this morning with everything that we have. And Lord, at this time, as we come together to give, Father, our offerings, our tithes, Father, we commit it into your hands. And we thank you, Father, for the opportunity that you give us to participate in this blessing. Lord, it belongs to you, so please take it. And may it be pleasing to you, Father. May it be honoring to you. Lord, what we are going to bless today, Lord, as our tithes and offering as your church, Lord, may it be used for the edification of your church, for the extension of your kingdom, Lord, to help the ones who are in need. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you have been faithful to us, that we do not, Lord, lack anything because you are our good shepherd. You are a faithful God. And we thank you, Lord, as we come together as church to offer our tithes and offering, we give it to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Tongues above.
to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it, seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it, seal it for thy courts above.
Today's scripture portion is taken from James chapter 3 verse 13 to James chapter 4 verse 12. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let him show it by his good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but it is earthly, unspiritual, of devil. For where have you envy and selfish ambition? There you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace raise a harvest of righteousness. Chapter 4, verse 1 to 12. What causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You want something, but don't get it. You kill and covet, but you cannot have what you want. You quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think, scripture says without reason, that the spirit he caused to live in us and weighs intensely? But he gives us more grace. That is why scripture says, God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. Brothers, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against his brother or judges him speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you are not keeping it, but sitting in judgment on it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor? These are the words of God. Now I invite Reverend Pongam Chai to deliver us the word of God for today's divine service. Thank you.
Thank you, Arman, for the clear reading. And thank you also for giving me the title before I actually got it. Anyway, thank you so much for the clear reading. And thank you, everyone, all the participants, for blessing us through your participations. Now, as we come to the Word of God, before we go into the text we have that is very clearly read to us, let us first look to God in prayer. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Dear God, our loving Heavenly Father, as we take time to meditate upon your word, we come to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Please speak to us and speak through your servant. With thanksgiving, we offer our prayers in Jesus' most blessed name. Amen. Today, before we go to the text, I have a fairy tale from Japan. And this fairy tale is translated or retold by William Elliot Griffiths. Perhaps this is the oldest version of this fairy tale, because there are many people translated or retold many times. Once upon a time, there was an old man who had a wife with a very bad temper. Here, I'm not targeting the women of our church or anyone. But the story goes like this. They had no child, and the wife did not want the trouble of adopting a child. So her husband had a pet, a tiny sparrow. The bad-tempered wife lived scolding her husband and hating his pet. One day, the old man went out in the hills, and that tiny sparrow pecked some starch from the bowl kept by his cruel mistress. The old woman, in her rage, cut the sparrow's tongue out and threw the bird in the ear. The poor sparrow flew away, bleeding, never to return. When the old man returned home, he found his pet gone. So he asked his wife, and she told what she did and why. The sorrowful old man grieved painfully for his pet. He searched everywhere, calling it by name, and at last gave up as lost. But long after this, the old man by chance met his old friend, the sparrow, while wandering in the mountains. They greeted each other with tears of joy. Then the sparrow begged the old man to visit his home, promising to introduce his wife and two little daughters. The old man obliged, and he was welcomed heartily and hosted for 4 days with utmost generosity and hospitality by Sparrow's family of four. The delighted old man forgot there with them all his cares, his old limbs, his wife's tongue, and felt like youth again. On the fifth day, when the old man said he must go, the sparrow brought a gift, parting gift, of two baskets. One was heavy and the other was light. The old man, being not greedy, took the light one and set off his journey back home after many bows and many goodbyes. When the old man reached home, instead of a kind welcome again, his wife began to scold for being away so long. The old man begged her to be quiet. He told his visit and then opened the basket. To their surprise, there were gold, silver coins, gems, and all manners of precious things. Now the greedy wife turned all of a sudden from her anger into laughter of greed. She asked her husband the direction and visited the sparrow's home. Why she visited, you know. The sparrow was not so pleased to see her, but he was kind enough to welcome his old mistress and listen to her flattery. Then when she had to leave, this old woman did not see any sign of parting gift. So she asked herself for a parting gift for of remembrance. The sparrow did the same, two baskets brought, and the old woman took the heavy one and left. When she arrived home, she quietly opened her basket, expecting precious keys, but there came out all sorts of creepy and scary creatures, poking, pushing, and squeezing her till she died. Now, coming to the text, last Sunday we meditated on chapter 3, beginning from verse 1 to 12, which warned us about the power of tongue. We were reminded that its power and influence is actually not proportionate to its size. It makes tremendous impact, whether it is for good or bad. So we learned that we must check our tongue. And we learned that we must surrender to the higher authority that can only tame our tongue, because no one can tame it. And it is essential to Christian lifestyle, because most of the time, bitter disagreement in the community, even within Christian circle, begins with the tongue. Today, we will meditate on the remaining verses of the same section of the letter, that is James chapter 3, beginning from verses 13 till chapter 4, till verse 1 to 12. So, the first point of our meditation is about wisdom, from chapter 3, verse 13, and from chapter 4, verse 1 to 4. James, this from chapter 3, verse 13 to chapter 4, verse 1 to 4, James identifies two kinds of wisdom. And one is earthly, the other one heavenly. Now, generally speaking, wisdom is the ability to use our knowledge and experience to make good decision and judgment. You will see this idea in all the dictionaries. But this definition is insufficient for Christians who are actually striving towards moral excellence. For Christians, those who are being transformed by the word of God. The simple reason is that our good decision and judgment is not always good, actually. In other words, even though the decision and judgment that we make is good from our perspective, it is not the same with others, from others' perspective. And some of you here this morning might have already experienced such a situation. I will leave it to you to ponder upon such situation. Now, let us look at the first kind of wisdom, that is earthly wisdom. What is earthly wisdom? According to this text and according to the Bible, as we have also studied in 1 Corinthians. Now, James begins this paragraph with a rhetoric question or rhetorical question. Who is wise and understanding among you? See, verse 13, chapter 3, verse 13a. Then he challenges, let him show by good conduct that his works are done in the meekness of wisdom. Remember, James is not making some baseless statements here. Unfortunately, there were members in the believing community who considered themselves wise or knowledgeable. At the same time, they were the ones causing this confusion or disorder in some other version. And every evil thing in the church. Here we have the word confusion, and it is described in chapter 4 verse 1 as wars and fights in the New King James Version. In other words, in other words, dissension or divisions, conflicts in the church. James is loud and clear about these people and the wisdom they claim to have. According to him and according to the scripture, the wisdom they possess is earthly, and therefore it is unspiritual and demonic. In some other version, of devil, you will see. That is in verse 15. James makes these bold statements because he knows that God is not the author of confusion, but of peace or harmony. And we can see clearly in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 33. If you get time, please read. Now, from this text, the Spirit of God reveals for us this morning that the so-called words of wisdom those individuals spoke out were powered or influenced by envy and self-seeking, consequently causing confusion and all evil things that were there, according to chapter 3, verse 16. These individuals knew that they lacked something despite claiming to have wisdom. That's why James says, you desire, but you do not have, so you kill. See, people who do not have this wisdom from above, people who are clinging to this earthly wisdom, they will always have that emptiness within them. They will always feel that something has to, feel this emptiness. See, they were not separated from pleasure-oriented lifestyle, or in other words, worldly lifestyle. Fights and quarrels were taking place. And James called them adulterous people. Just as the Old Testament prophets called Israelites for breaking their vows to love and serve God and follow idols instead, James is calling them adulterous people here. An illicit affair with worldliness results in estrangement and hostility with God. We need to remember this. And there is a danger to be in enmity with God. See? This revelation calls us to pay careful attention and examine ourselves, not others. Please do not go judging others. The text says no. And even if we sense that there exist among us these characteristics the Bible reveals as unspiritual and demonic, we must not plunge into judging. Instead, we must start praying. And if we are experiencing symptoms of this earthly wisdom, which is unspiritual and demonic, ourselves, we must seek God's help for deliverance. See, no matter how experienced you are in the ministry or in the society, how much degree you have, or irrespective of your degrees, your experience, your wealth, if your presence, if my presence is causing problems, confusions, rather than peace and harmony, remember, we are still with the worldly wisdom, and we must make sure that we avoid, see, being there, or we must make sure that we come out of that situation, because there is judgment as mentioned in chapter 3, verse 1. We remember the old man and his wife in the fairy tale. They shared the same surname, lived under the same roof, and visited the same sparrow. At the end, one received blessing and the other curse. We may share the same name, Christians, attend the same church, read the same Bible, went to the same seminary, but we could end up receiving different things at the end. Therefore, we must be careful And we must ask God to help us show our good conduct to the world in the meekness of wisdom, as James challenged in chapter 3, verse 13. See, the word meekness in this text is also translated gentleness in Galatians chapter 5, verse 3, and in some other portion of the text. This meekness or gentleness does not actually come from cowardice or passivity. I'm not encouraging anyone to be scared of your responsibility or to be coward, to be always sitting at the back. Actually, this meekness comes from trusting God, and this frees a person from anxious self-promotions. That takes us to the next sub-point under the wisdom. So let's discuss about heavenly wisdom. Chapter 3, verses 17 to 18. Coming to this point, we don't need to spend much time because we have already got the idea of what heavenly wisdom is, as we discuss about the earthly wisdom. Because when we talk about the day, we come to know about the night. When we talk about the night, we also get the picture of what the day is like, right? So let's read verse 17 from this chapter 3. It says, "But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere." According to this chapter and verse, see, the answer to the disorder or confusion of verse 16 is to seek wisdom from above. And this wisdom produces strong character. We can read Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 to 23 as well when we get time. Now, first of all, wisdom produces purity, and this purity is the primary virtue, and the other godly qualities result from this moral purity. So, who are the people in the community of believers that possess heavenly wisdom or the true wisdom? They are the ones with pure heart. They are the ones who promote peace and harmony. They are the ones who are submissive to the authority of Christ, the final judge. They are the ones who are full of mercy, who bear good fruit, who are impartial and sincere. These people with heavenly wisdom, according to the scripture, are reaping in verse 18 of this chapter 3, are reaping the harvest of righteousness, and they will reap it. Let me read aloud verse 18 for all of us. "Peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. In the word of Jesus, they are called the blessed ones," or the blessed ones. Let's read Jesus' own words from the gospel according to Matthew chapter 5, verse 3 to 9. This is also known as the Beatitudes, or the part of the Sermon on the Mount. From chapter 5, verse 3 to 9, I will read for all of us. "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God." Hallelujah. We are called to live a blessed life, not a cursed life. And therefore, we need to shun, or we need to separate ourselves from the worldly wisdom and go for this heavenly wisdom. So let's check our standing today. Where do we stand? On the blessedness or on the cursed side? Think about the fairy tale we heard in the beginning. Given a choice, which one would you choose? The old man or the old woman? The heavy basket or the light one? In fact, Jesus says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 11, verse 29 to 30. Sometimes we think that the worldly things are far more better. They are easy. They are light. They are easy to do. That's what we feel. But in reality, just like the old woman had to carry this heavy basket through the forest and reach her home just about to die. See? And after having reached, when she opened all sorts of these dangerous creatures, it's actually easier and lighter, the burden that we carry with Jesus, because he is the one who carries our burden. Therefore, heavenly wisdom is preferred to the earthly wisdom. And that takes us to the final point of our meditation. Chapter 4, verse 5 till 12. The scripture teaches us that submission is the solution to our sin problems. See here in this text. And we know that holding on to the worldly wisdom is sin. We must let it go. And here, submission does not mean a theoretical one. It is not about mere learning or knowing something. It's about doing it. To submit to God here means being practical. Just as a servant would submit to his master and do what his master tells him or her to do, a Christian must do what God tells him or her to do. See, this is the point here. If he or she does not, or if he or she does it, he is submissive, otherwise he is not. The bad news we have in the text is that God opposes the proud. But it is followed by the good news, and it goes like this. But shows favor to the humble. Verse 6 in chapter 4. Now, even when God discloses the bad news, or even when God brings the bad news, he actually intends to give you the good news. This is the beauty of God's dealing with his people. See, those who are quarrelsome, divisive, and those who are proud and adulterous, they are sinful. Nevertheless, God will receive these same people if only they returned in humility, submitting to God and not to devil. This is the message we get from these concluding verses. According to the rhetorical question that is put forward in verse 4, chapter 4, verse 5, chapter 4, verse 5, it is crystal clear that God wants to protect what is rightfully his, because he created mankind with a spirit, and he deeply desires that our spirits worship him. It is also clearly mentioned in John chapter 4, verse 23 to 24. He has not only created us, he has also redeemed us. And so he deserves our worship and fellowship. That's why submission is for solution to our problems. Submission is required. It is interesting to notice that James closes this section with a word of reminder to avoid speaking evil of one another, as he started with a similar warning, the power of tongue, in chapter 3, verse beginning from verse 2. See? Power of tongue, which is like wildfire that destroys the forest, is if one leaves untamed or unchecked. I think not to speak ill about others is one of the most difficult thing for us as humans, even as believers. And unfortunately, to speak evil of one another is to judge one another, which is actually rebellion against God, because He alone is judge of all, according to Psalms 9:19, Isaiah 2:4, Joel 3:12, and perhaps in other passages as well. So when a person begins to judge, when a person begins to speak evil against another person, he rebels against the lawgiver, the judge, that is God. Therefore, no matter whether it is hard or not, we must remember that the Word of God commands us to overcome it. And submission to God includes this abstaining from speaking evil of others. It's not only about, see, fighting literally, taking others to court or involving in violence. It is more than that. Therefore, submission also includes coming to God in the name of Jesus, our Lord, lifting up our hands and saying, I cannot do this alone. Please help me. See? Because it is hard for us and it is not possible indeed. So we come, help me, please. Our Lord Jesus has a promise in John chapter 14, verse 30. He says this, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. When you become a man who possesses spiritual wisdom or the heavenly wisdom, when you become a man separated from the worldly wisdom, God is glorified. God is glorified. So let us remember today and always that, yes, we all claim to have wisdom. Yes, we all claim to have experience. Yes, we all claim to have making good decisions. But some of our wisdom are earthly wisdom. We must separate from it and go for the heavenly wisdom that comes from above, that comes from God. And in order to receive this, we need to submit to God. We need to surrender our lives to God and become a practical Christian, living by faith, living in faith. Shall we all unite our hearts and look to God in prayer and also receive the benediction? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Our God, our Father, thank you once again for the word that has come to us. Help us to remember and always sought after the heavenly wisdom, separating ourselves from the worldly wisdom, from quarrelsome, from confusion, from disorder, but look for peacemaking. Look for unity, harmony, look for love, look for forgiveness, look for mercy. Help us, Lord, to be always submissive, because we know and we have learned that submission is the only solution to our problems. Now with these words of blessing, as we come to the close of our worship and fellowship, may the eternal love of God, our Father, and the amazing grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the everlasting, ever-abiding presence of the Holy Spirit, raise and abide with us, both now and forevermore. Amen. Please remain, stay back for the announcement and also for the blessing song. Here I will go quickly for the announcement. The 8 core leaders meeting will be held this evening at 7 p.m. So please remember us in your prayer. And the trustees meeting is also coming very soon. We have not exactly finalized, but likely to happen this coming week. And regarding the Pathfinders mission trip organized by EnderServe, we are likely to withdraw our participation because of the situation and because of the lack of participants this time. But we will look forward for the another opportunity that most probably will come after some months. And we also want to know the members that our associate pastor Dindu is arriving tonight, midnight. So please keep him and his journey in your prayers. And finally, regarding the men's Bible study, I will try to here I cannot share the screen right now because I have withdrawn from the host, but the NCF men's Bible study is going very well. If there is anyone willing to join, you may kindly contact our brother John, one of the Bible study leaders, and his number is 98341730 59. Our brother John Macha, you may kindly contact him. His contact number is 98341730 59. The Bible study, I will want to encourage all of you to join, because there it is not just one-way traffic. We all come together and interact. It is very interesting. And not only the text that we are studying on a particular morning, we also clarify our doubts. It is really amazing to be in the presence of the brothers there, open to share, encourage, and help one another. And we also pray during the Bible study, especially before and after. We pray for our church. We pray for the sick. We pray for all our needs, and we remember those who are traveling, so on and so forth. So you are most welcome to join the Bible study, both men and women, and please contact our brother John and our sister Priyanka, and you can even contact some of us. Now over to our worship team for the blessing song. Thank you, everyone.
Hello, church. As we sing this blessing song, we especially want to bless those who are celebrating birthdays, anniversaries, and those who are traveling this week.
Have a blessed week.
Thank you, Pastor. Bye, everyone.
Bye.